Call the Midwife starts tonight at 8 on BBC One.
Another part of the Great Barrier Reef story to tell with David Attenborough in 35 minutes. Before that on BBC One, Songs of Praise with John Craven.
This winter, the UK has seen the wettest weather on record for more than a century. Tens of thousands of homes were flooded in the severe storms in Northern Ireland, Wales, the north of England, and right up to Aberdeenshire in Scotland. On today's Songs of Praise, I'm in Kendal, one of the first communities to suffer from this extreme weather, to discover how the long road to recovery is being eased by community spirit and acts of kindness. We'll be meeting individuals who were caught up in the rising waters.
Just absolutely mental. I'm absolutely shattered.
And we'll see how churches have been a focal point as different parts of the community rallied together, forming lasting bonds.
As a result of all this now, I've made more friends in the last 4 or 5 weeks than I have in the last 20 years.
And David Grant is in Twickenham to find out why one young man chose to sing the much-loved worship song 10,000 Reasons whilst undergoing brain surgery. And of course, we've also got a selection of inspiring music from across the country, starting right here in Cumbria. From the Keswick Convention in the majestic North Lakes, here's one of my favourite hymns, led by the ever-popular Stuart Townend and Band. The storms that wreaked havoc in December and into January devastated large parts of Britain. Schools were closed, hospital services cancelled, and many counties declared major incidents.
You know, all our hearts go out to them. To be flooded is a terrible experience anyway, and it's even more terrible when it happens at Christmas or New Year.
It's just horrific. At this time of year, especially.
Can you just make sure it's unlocked and we'll come in and we'll have a chat?
The army and other services were called to the rescue as thousands were evacuated from their homes. And flood warnings remain, even today. Cumbria was one of the first counties to be affected.
Storm Desmond broke all previous UK records last month when, here in Cumbria, no less than 330 millilitres of rain, that's more than a foot of it, fell in just one 24-hour period. It completely ruined Christmas for thousands of people, and it's going to take communities many months to rebuild themselves.
...30 to 40 houses that are being flooded at least. So you can see where the level of the water is reached on this house.
The Sandylands estate here in Kendal is an area not used to flooding. Storm Desmond took the 3,000 residents completely by surprise.
Just absolutely mental. I'm absolutely shattered. But we've got the community coming together, and that's brilliant.
Community worker the Reverend Johnny Gios filmed events on his mobile as they unfolded and helped a grandmother and two young children escape from their home.
Hold on to Chris.
Sandylands Methodist Church, where Johnny works, became an emergency relief centre, working together with other local churches.
That is for those people who really desperately need to get assistance immediately.
Their church was flooded, but its members opened the doors anyway today, their mission to help the parts of Kendal in most desperate need. They went onto the streets of the Sandylands estate and into houses which lie devastated. This is not a wealthy community.
Calling on people who are in government, local government, to come down here and to actually see Sandylands itself and the state that's what's happened around here, and the people who are vulnerable, the people who are destitute and really lost everything and got no insurance, to come down and help them and see what they can do.
The church itself didn't escape the rising floodwaters, and today it's operating from what they call the encouragement cabin. Now a building site, everything here has been contaminated by floodwater and sewage and is heading for the skip. But the priority for Johnny and the team is supporting the community.
And how are you able to help people? Is there any help available?
Well, that's what at the moment we're looking at, is trying to get those people who have offered their services for plastering, for building work, to actually come up from the various areas of the UK to help and assist with that work. And that's going to take a bit of coordination.
And how significant do you think it was for the community that all this happened shortly before Christmas, and Christmas was not the same as it should have been for anybody?
No, I mean, it wasn't. A lot of people lost Christmas presents, and various things were supposed to be on here at the church in terms of Christingle services, carol services. They didn't happen. I've really kind of struggled with this over this Christmas, but remembering the Christmas message that God sent his son Jesus into the mess and muck 2,000 years ago, and then we're deployed as his ambassadors, his people, to go into the mess and muck to help people and to be shining lights for him.
Oh,
Repair work after the floods is underway across Britain, including the Sandylands estate here in Cumbria. It'll be many months before newlyweds Sarah and Dave Benjamin can move back into their new home after it was flooded by 3 feet of water.
Wow, awful lot still to do here.
Incredible. It's bringing all the memories back to me. What can I say? It's just horrible.
You can see how high the water was, and we was
This is a sort of tide mark here, isn't it?
Mm. Yes.
So up to your waist.
Yeah, up to our waist.
Did you wade in?
We did, yeah, in contaminated water. It was cold, it was dark. It was quite scary, really, yeah.
The fridge freezer was at the bottom, and that was floating around, banging into things. So I was just picking up some of the sentimental things quickly and getting them upstairs as best and as fast as I could. But my memories of one thing in particular, the Christmas tree floating around,
really?
Yeah, with the lights on still, in all the darkness, it was incredible to see.
And the irony is that you've been good Samaritans, haven't you?
We went to help at the church. We were waist high in water then because it flooded down near our local church first. I went and got a lady out of her property. She was too scared to leave, but we managed to persuade her and get her to safety. And when we came back, our property was probably one of the worst affected. Yes. And I felt even more violated when all our personal possessions were put out on the front for the local council to come and fetch. I've had to start again from scratch. But we're here, we've got a faith, and we're pulling together. And I know that, you know, God's here and he's watching over us, and we're going to be all right. And the town's going to rebuild from this stronger, bigger and better.
And what about Christmas itself? What was that like?
Christmas this year was about being together. It wasn't about lavish gifts. It was just about spending time together with loved ones and people who we've met along the way. And that's what we've done. And we've had a better Christmas by not spending loads of money and lavishing people, just being together, going to church, carol singing. It's been fantastic.
As a result of all this now, people have come together as one, and I've made more friends in the last 4 or 5 weeks than I have in the last 20 years. Yeah.
So flooding has provided a common bond.
Absolutely. So much so that when I see these people now, they give you big hugs, yeah? And the warmth and the strength, yeah, that helps you carry on to get through this is just remarkable.
We'll be hearing more from Kendall later in the programme, and I'll be helping to deliver some Meals on Wheels. But first, here's our next hymn, and it's one that really resonates with many of the people round here.
Well, here in the Lake District, there's still no shortage of rain. Coming up, we've got a truly inspiring story about a young man who sang as he underwent groundbreaking brain surgery. But first, we're off to the Hackney Empire in London.
Can you imagine how anxious you'd be if you needed a life-saving brain operation and one of the possible side effects was losing the ability to speak and sing? That's the situation that physics student and keen singer Reuben Hill faced last year. And remarkably, to check his brain wasn't being damaged during his surgery, doctors woke him and asked him to sing something.
The sun comes up, it's a new day dawn. The sun
comes up. He sang 10,000 Reasons, a favourite worship song written by my good friend Matt Redman. Reuben is well on the road to recovery now. And I've come to St Margaret's Church in Twickenham to gatecrash his music rehearsal.
I had at least three conditions, one of which was a brain tumour. And I was told, you're gonna have to have surgery. We'll take it out.
Well, that was groundbreaking surgery they'd planned. Can you explain it a bit?
It was awake surgery, so during the surgery, I had to constantly be singing and speaking. And I knew that if I was going to sing, it should be a prayer. It should be a prayer, because if ever I needed prayer, it was in that moment. Yeah. And I wanted to just appeal to God, and so I sang 10,000 Reasons.
The sun comes up, it's a new day dawn.
Reuben's tumour is near the part of the brain that controls speech.
BBC cameras followed Reuben's story, and his song choice gained worldwide exposure.
The effect of that has been kind of extraordinary. It meant that what would otherwise have been just a news report about some science, really important science, turned into something so much more, like as an act of witness that I just couldn't have predicted at all, and I'm deeply humbled by. If I ever had any doubt about the kind of the worldwide reach of Christian love, I now, you know, I can never dispel that forever. I mean, I got loads of Twitter followers all of a sudden, and I had to send out a tweet saying, thank you for all these prayers. Please don't just pray for me, pray for all the people that don't have anyone to pray for them or who are by themselves.
It wasn't just Twitter followers who were touched by Reuben's act of witness. Matt Redman is on tour at the moment, but he wanted me to hand deliver a special invitation. Have a look at this.
Hey, Reuben, Matt Redman here. Hope you're doing well. It was so amazing to see how you used the song recently when you came through from your operation, and amazing how these songs can show up in surprising places. This might be one of the most surprising so far. I'd love to meet you sometime, and hoping maybe you could come to one of the tour nights. We could get to say hi. You sound like an amazing person, and you've been through quite a journey, so it'd be great to meet. God bless, and hope to meet you soon.
Yeah. Oh, wow, that's amazing. So let my life be
undivided God. And just before Christmas, Reuben travelled to Oxford to meet Matt.
I've had a bit taken out of me, but actually, for me as a person, I've grown and become filled. I have a sense of being aware that I have so many options in terms of what I could do in my life, and I want to do whatever God thinks is best, because if I'm doing his will, then I'll be a very happy man.
The sun comes up, it's a new day dawn. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the
In the aftermath of the severe winter floods, communities have rallied, as we heard earlier, and in Kendal, local churches and businesses have been working together to offer practical help. Jane and David Robinson live outside the Sandylands estate, and they too have been volunteering their services for free. Another delivery coming up. Hello. Yes. What's on the van today?
We've got a chili and rice today, but also we've got soup, and we thought we'd perhaps take some cleaning materials round for people, because it's just convenient that we can drop them off for them, really.
Yeah, great. So and what got you into this? Because you're not from the Sandylands area, are you?
No, but we're fortunate, aren't we? We've been lucky. We haven't been affected by flooding, and we felt we wanted to just try and help people who had. We came down to Sandylands, to the Methodist Church, because we realised there was a lot of action here. A lot of people haven't got cooking facilities.
No.
You know, they've been totally washed out. Their whole lives have been sort of rushed out the door in the floods. It's been devastating.
As you've been handing over the meals, you must have heard some fascinating stories.
Well, I would say tragic stories, to be honest. People are just so pleased, apart from getting the food, which is just brilliant, they enjoy actually having somebody there to talk to. And they realise that this community cares, actually, and that's a big factor. People are just devastated and overwhelmed by it all.
Yeah.
You go on to people and they say, oh, there are people worse off than me.
Yeah.
And when you think, I don't think there are.
Yeah.
So who's the next customer then?
Well, we're going across the road to Mr. Duxbury.
Is this the gentleman who's marooned on the top floor of his house?
He is, yeah, he is, having to live upstairs. So we'll take him some food, and I thought you might like to take him a bottle of bleach, which could be very useful.
Oh, yeah, of course.
And,
yeah.
Well, you could take him an assortment and see what he would like.
See what he wants, yeah.
Who's
to
meet you?
Mr. Craven.
Yes.
He's brought you your
Here's
dinner
your
today.
Oh, thank you.
Do you like chilli?
Yes, yes.
Well, you're in for a treat then.
Right, thank you.
What difference has it made to you, Mr. Duxbury, getting these meals every day?
Tremendous. A great help.
So where were you when the flood happened?
I was upstairs at the moment, at the time, when I looked out of the bedroom window and saw the water was level with the garden wall.
And you were trapped?
I was trapped, yes. I couldn't get out. In due course, the water went down.
And now you're upstairs?
I'm upstairs.
Almost permanently?
Yes, yes. Thank you.
Would you be useful to have some bleach?
Yes, I would. I'm really sure.
Well, that's an interesting
mixture
of things.
And you know you can always get it down at Sandylands Church. They always have stuff to help you with.
Enjoy your lunch, then.
Thank you very much.
Nice to see you. All the very best.
Thank you.
See you again. Take care.
Thank you.
Bye, Mr. Duxbury. Bye.
And that's just about it today from Kendal, a town recovering from its devastating flood. And I'd like to thank everybody here who's made me feel so welcome in these very trying times. Now, next week, David Grant will be meeting people in a rehab centre who are turning to God as they try to free themselves from their addictions. Until then, here's our final hymn today, and it's been chosen by some of the people that I've been meeting. Bye for now.
And Songs of Praise back slightly later at 4:30 next Sunday. Coming next on BBC One, David Attenborough explores the Great Barrier Reef. Tonight, Granville injects a little piece of wedding day sunshine into still open all hours at 7:30. Our favourite nurses are back at 8 for the new series of Call the Midwife. And there's a jewel on the cards when the epic drama of War and Peace continues at 9. That's your Sunday night here on BBC One.
This is possibly the most important moment in your entire lives.
Times that I've seen you lose your way, you're not in control, and you won't be told. All I can do to keep you safe, hold you close.
Here it comes.
It's a new year. It's a new start. I believe it's going to be cushy.
We're finally here.
So Call the Midwife returns with a new look for the new series later, pure drama from 8 tonight. But now on BBC One, David Attenborough dives deep for one.